brought to you by DK Audio.
DK Audio presents The Food Book, the stories, science and history of what we eat, by DK, read by Charles Armstrong. Foreword. When I was a small boy of maybe 10 or 11, my dream breakfast was a bowl of Cocoa Pops with a little muesli mixed in, full cream milk, and then a light dusting of Ready Breck on the top, like newly fallen snow. The powdery oat cereal would fill out the crunchier chocolate mouthfuls, while the raisins and oats at the bottom fattened gradually in the browning chocolatey milk. Oh, what heaven to blend so many good things and to make something wholly new, wholly mine. What a delicious expression of my nascent self. Except, I never did. It remained forever a breakfast enjoyed only in my dreams, because my parents, who were very strict about food, would not allow it. No mixing of cereals in one bowl. I don't know why. I was told only because. Because food rules and the story of food are like that, shrouded in mystery, but strongly believed in. Because we all think we know everything about food, when in fact we mostly know nothing. Take Galen, the hugely influential classical Greek physician, who I discover from the pages of this extraordinary book, thought fruit was linked to cold, wet humours, and gave you diarrhoea, thus condemning generations of Europeans to scurvy from vitamin C deprivation. Or the Chinese, who thought carp turned into dragons when they spawned. Or the Germans, who tied frisky horses to raspberry canes to calm them. The horses, not the raspberries. Or the North American scientists of the 1950s, who falsely linked coronary heart disease with a diet high in animal fats, creating the carb-heavy diet full of sugary flavourings that has given us our current obesity crisis and threatens to lower life expectancy in the developed world for the first time since the Black Death. I'm not sure if that last one is in here. It is a big book, but it bugs me. Ignorance. The ignorance that mistreats animals with bad husbandry, contaminates water tables with poorly administered chemicals, fills the seas with single-use plastics, drink tap water, you lemons, and overexposes children to fast, colourful, nutritionally catastrophic foods that set in motion a lifetime of bad habits. This book is an antidote to that ignorance. It is an essential contribution to the ongoing debate about how we eat now, and what and why and since when, and for how much longer. It comes at this enormous subject in a multidisciplinary blizzard of enthusiasm, like the great encyclopedias of the Enlightenment, attacking food from historical, political, cultural, scientific, and medical angles in ways that make it gripping as a sit-down read, compulsive as an idle browse, and indispensable as a reference tool. And if you're not a big reader, you'll learn more from a flick through the dazzling images that illustrate it than you would from 1,000 articles in the daily food press, apart from mine. Find out how meat changed our brains, why having a walnut for a brain is no bad thing in Afghanistan, and what the drains in Pompeii tell us about eating giraffes. But first, I think it is time for what Winnie the Pooh called a little smackerel of something. Cocoa Pops and muesli, I think, with just the lightest scattering of Ready Breck. Giles Corran. Introduction. From prehistoric hunter-gatherers to modern culinary superstars, food has occupied a prominent position in the human psyche. As a species, we depend upon food for survival. But how it is obtained, prepared, and consumed has shaped us as much as our quest for it has shaped plants, animals, and the environment. Over the course of human history, food has become a potent topic, assuming enormous social, environmental, and commercial significance. The production of food has evolved into a massive global enterprise, and for many people a trip to the supermarket may be all the effort required in order to obtain the calories and nutrients needed to survive. Hardwired for nutrients. The ancient hunt for sustenance is mostly gone, but the quest for it is in our DNA, and our relationship with food remains as complex and vital as it ever was. From the time early humans learned how to harness the power of wild foods and began to make the right tools for hunting and butchering, cultivation and domestication, the process of evolution gained pace, allowing them to get enough nourishment not just to survive, but to thrive. Researchers believe that between 2 million and 3.9 million years ago, a shift took place in the diet of early humans in Africa, which propelled them to exploit new sources of food and forced them into different environments as a consequence. When paleontologists examined the tooth enamel of several species of early humans found in present-day Ethiopia, they discovered that some of them had added new types of plant foods to their diet. These plants, such as tubers, succulents, cabbage, and maize, were especially nutrient and energy dense, and this new source of food channeled more calories into brain development. In the process, our taste receptors evolved to detect poisons in plants, distinguishing between foods that tasted bitter and were deadly, those that tasted slightly less bitter and were nutritious, and others that tasted sweet and would provide a fast-acting energy boost. Food meant the difference between life and death, between a growing, prosperous population and a struggling one, and it assumed great social, religious, and cultural significance. The quest to find, hunt, and grow food forced people to cooperate, to arrange society in such a way that it maximized food production. On a hunt, this meant that different members of a community assumed specialist roles in order to ensure the best chances of a kill. Once herding and grain agriculture became established, more complex forms of organization and cooperation were required, pushing communities to innovate, invent, and become efficient, not only at food production, but at storing, transporting, and trading it. A surplus of food also allowed more children to survive to adulthood, triggering a population explosion. Thus, a subsistence existence gave way to a thriving society with many different aspects. Along with archaeological and anthropological finds, such as cave paintings, utensils, bones, and chemical traces of foodstuffs, much of what anthropologists and historians know about early food production and consumption comes from a limited number of texts, such as early recipe books and trade accounts. From these sources, we now know that our ancestors were deep-sea fishing for tuna in Southeast Asia, for example, making cheese in what is now Poland and keeping bees in ancient Egypt. How meat-eating affected the brain. Eating more meat was another crucial dietary change that provided further fuel for the expansion and evolution of the human brain. And as our ancestors' brains developed, so too did their ability to innovate. Developing tools with cutting edges gave groups the ability to hunt cooperatively, enabling them to bring down large game instead of scavenging the kills of other predators. This progression occurred over a long period of time, beginning with the use of basic scraper tools around 2.6 million years ago, which allowed meat to be butchered, to the creation of thrusting spears, the earliest of which date back approximately 500,000 years. How cooking changed the world. Once humans had harnessed fire, they began to cook their food, a development that heralded the beginning of a love affair with culinary experimentation, commentary, and eventually the art of entertaining. Most importantly, however, cooking unlocked different nutrients in certain foods by breaking down proteins, carbohydrates, and fats to make them easier to digest. It also killed germs that caused food poisoning, and even eradicated poisons from some plants. Only when a potato is cooked, for example, does it release its starches in a form that can be efficiently absorbed by the human gut. It is believed that all of these factors contributed to our biological development in many different ways. Cooked food led to smaller jaws and smaller intestines, while increased calorie consumption led to bigger brains. But the changing relationship between humans and their food supply was also the catalyst for social and technological advances. Fine dining in the ancient world. The 3rd century CE Greek writer Athenaeus of Naucratis provides modern readers with a fascinating glimpse of food in ancient times in his encyclopedic Deipnosophistae, otherwise known as the Sophists at Dinner. Essentially, a collection of quotations from various dinner parties.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.